Welcome to this week's installment of Reading with Robin, your number one destination since 2002 for insightful author interviews and discussions on everything literary. And with no further introduction, your host, Robin Call.
Lydia Denworth is a Brooklyn-based science journalist whose work is supported by the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation. We are so excited that she will be joining us in Rhode Island February 18th. She's also a contributing writer for Scientific American and Psychology Today and has written for The Atlantic, The New York Times, Friendship, The Evolution, Biology, and Extraordinary Power of Life's Fundamental Bond is just out, and I am thrilled to have her on the show. Welcome, Lydia, to Reading with Robin.
Hi, Robin. It's great to be here.
I am so excited to have you. And when this book came out, firstly, the book is out by Norton. We love working with Norton. You have such a fabulous team behind you and your book. It's great to be able to, you know, we do all sorts of interviews, but especially when authors are coming through to our series, it's even more fun because I get to say, come meet Lydia on February 18th at the Cardigan Connection in Providence, Rhode Island. So that's even, you know, just an added bit. But when the book arrived a long time ago, it jumped right out at me, especially when there's nonfiction that we cover, the topics are compelling. And as soon as I saw this big friendship, you know, are those friendship bracelets, I guess, on the cover?
They are, with DNA in them.
Oh, yes.
Get it?
I've got the part of that covered, but yes, that's DNA. Okay, that does make sense.
Right. I know not everyone will get it, but I think it's really clever.
It's so clever. Well, I got them as bracelets, but now that I'm looking, certainly that's DNA. Now, did they make you bracelets? Are there bracelets?
I have actual bracelets. I had them made, to tell you the truth. Computer generated image, and then I had bracelets made to match.
That's so cool. Like someone actually sat there and made because there's nothing
exactly.
Like those friendship bracelets.
No.
So are you going to wear them?
I will be wearing it on February 18th. I will be wearing my bracelets that match my cover.
We must get a shot of that. I love it. Well, you can also find Lydia on Instagram. I don't know if there's a picture of it there. You can find her on Facebook and at lydiadenworth.com. I guess you're on Twitter, right? I'm so bad at
Twitter. I'm on Twitter,
yeah.
I'm primarily on Twitter and Facebook. I do have an Instagram account, but it's until the last week or two, it's been mostly a way just to keep an eye on my kids, I admit.
Hey, you know something? Friendship is one thing. Children's another. So that's absolutely a valid scenario for sure. I'm just not on Twitter as much as I used to be. And it's an interesting thing. But I love that you're going to be wearing your friendship bracelets. This is awesome. So this is the show where we just talk about
Robin,
the cover of the book.
I will give you some. I will bring friendship bracelets for you.
Thank you. I didn't even have to ask. See, you're already a dear friend, Lydia. And it's kind of like that. Just there's so much about this book and the science, the evolution, biology, the genes, you know, just and all the things we know about friendship or we hear. But there's so – I love the way you tell a story, and the research in here is so enjoyable. And, of course, it makes you want to – I'm sure it's been written somewhere – call your friend – or wonder what happened to that friendship, or is it ever too late for a friendship, and why do things, you know, what are expectations of friendships, and is everybody's being met? And one of the most jarring things to jump out at me, which is, of course, true, is that, and there are a lot of facts that came on the sheet, so I was sort of going through those, that a friendship is often the first thing to go when we get stressed, when we're busy, when there's family. You know, there's always prioritizing. So let's jump in there with prioritizing friendship and what happens when it doesn't get prioritized.
Right.
Yeah.
If people take one message from this book, I hope it is that.
Good.
So you are right on the ball there. I think that this book, I mean, everybody thinks of friendship generally as very pleasurable and lovely and, you know, but also kind of squishy and, you know, and in fact, friendship, it is those things. It's pleasurable and it's enjoyable and all of that, but it also turns out to be essential for our health, both mental and physical. There's a biology and an evolution to friendship, and it's as important for your health as diet and exercise. And so that means that, you know, we really have to pay attention to it all through our lives.
Yeah.
We can't just wait until we're, you know, working less, retiring, or mm-hmm. our kids are grown. And I have three kids. I have a busy career and a husband and a mother to take care of and all kinds of
yeah.
things. So I know from from stress and busyness. But really, there is this kind of tendency we have to, we think we appreciate friendship, and we even think maybe we're doing okay with it. But so mm-hmm. often we are actually sort of canceling on our friends or saying, yes, yes, let's get together. And then we never uh-huh. really follow through. And
yeah.
I'm not saying you have to do it all the time, but you have to do some of it. You want to just be building those muscles and that bench of relationships your whole life. And let me just say that I hope people will not feel that I am adding to their to-do list, but instead that what I want people to take away is that I'm giving them permission to hang out with their friends. Because
well, that's a good way of looking at it, right? It's not like,
yeah.
oh, well, there's nothing, this is just pure, not that there's anything wrong
not,
with pure pleasure
no,
and enjoyment, but that there's
have,
a benefit.
Right. If you have a work deadline or your kid, you know, you
right.
feel you need to be home with your kid every time, sure, those things matter, but not maybe all the time. In fact, a really funny thing that happened, I just had my big launch here in Brooklyn, which, of course,
yes.
is my hometown crowd, and I had lots and lots of my friends is a fellow writer, and he's on deadline, and he's really pulling his hair out. And he uh-huh. had been planning to come, and then he had thought on the day, I just can't do it. I have to stay home and work. And his wife said, no, this is a book about friendship, and you have to go. And when I said this in my talk about giving you permission and telling you that it matters and it's important, you're doing something good for yourself, and it's not that, you know, the work is important, but it's not the only thing. And he laughed. He so took it to heart. He said, wow, okay.
Awesome.
I'm so glad I came. So
that's awesome. And that's the thing is, I think we're always glad when we show up and we're there for those moments, because on the flip side, if something is really stressing and there is that deadline or whatever, a friend, we would assume would be the first one to understand, maybe more so than family member. And yet those relationships, like you say, can be squishy and it can be fraught. But I think, you know, you sort of have to do your own check-in, I guess, to know, like, am I always canceling on the same person, or are you not re-upping
right. I think
the invitation?
Yeah, that's the important part is, you know, look for those patterns in your own behavior, right? And
mm-hmm.
And just sort of do a little bit of a check-in, as you say. That's exactly right.
It is the idea of why, you know, what makes it pleasurable to see a friend, and what are those connections, and what is the honesty between those friends, and where that time is well spent, or is it a friend that you feel like, well, you've been friends forever, sort of going through the motions, and you don't leave feeling energized? Because there are times to cut out friendships. Do you have simple advice for when it's time to say, this one's not serving anybody, it's kind of gone?
I do, actually.
Yeah.
The most important thing is the quality of the relationship. And the thing I hear a lot is a little bit what you just said, is that especially those older friendships,
mm-hmm.
that shared history can be really, really powerful and special and wonderful. And in fact, a critical element of friendship is that it is a long-lasting bond, and that you have to have put in the time to
mm-hmm.
consider someone a friend. You might like them from the minute you meet, but you really aren't friends and won't consider yourself friends generally until you have spent some serious time together.
Well,
and
there are hours. It's like teaching. It's like when you go for yoga training, and it's X amount of hours. So I love that there was math involved with that.
There is math. I loved that somebody actually counted. And it's 50 hours to go from being an acquaintance to a friend, and about 200 to consider someone a best friend. 200 hours is a lot of hours, you know?
Yeah. Well, you just divide them years.
Adult.
Yeah.
And it explains part of why we make so many friends in college and things like that. There's just a whole lot more time spent
mm-hmm.
hanging out, right? And,
yeah.
you know, I mean, people are busy in – we hope they're busy in school, going to class and doing their work, but they're also socializing a lot. And so it's – but So you need to put in that time. And to get back to your question, in addition to the time, though, the relationship has to be positive. It has to make you feel good and make the other person feel good. And there has to be a kind of reciprocity and cooperation to it. Those are the three most essential, most sort of universal themes. So it's long-lasting, it's positive, and it's cooperative. And if some of your friendships are not serving all of those things, are not hitting those points, then it is time to kind of think about, well, you know, where does this person belong in my life? And one of the really interesting things about the biology is that ambivalent relationships about, you know, people where we have, there's some good and some bad and, you know, mm-hmm. we love them, but they're draining. The word draining seems to come up a lot when people talk about
exhausting and exhausting,
right?
Depleted energy afterwards,
that,
right?
You know, those relationships are straight up bad for your biology. And the scientists who looked at it thought that maybe the positive would outweigh the negative. They didn't know what they'd find, but they have found that it's bad for your cardiovascular system. It's bad. Your cells actually age faster, when you have negative relationships. And unfortunately, the positive doesn't always outweigh the negative. So I guess that means you have two choices. One is, you know, if it's really bad, maybe this person shouldn't be so much in your life, but probably more often it's this ex, and you either can, you know, end the friendship or you have to put in some time to make it better. And I can't speak to people have to make that decision for themselves. Right. But the other thing I've realized is that, you know, we have these kind of concentric circles of friendship. Most of us have an average of four people who are really close to us, and that can include family. But when I say those four people are the people that you feel really bonded to and close to, and then it goes out in concentric circles, and maybe you just shuffle the furniture of your friendships. Like maybe that draining friend just moves a little bit further out, and you know you don't see her or him quite so often, and you know you set up some boundaries and you make sure that those core relationships are really strong and positive.
Well, that makes really good sense. The thing that I would find tricky, I felt like saying, you know, I'm asking for a friend.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I figured that worked in there well. But unless you have that discussion, if one is sort of pulling away and moving a friend to an outer circle and that friend doesn't understand and then there's misunderstandings, chances are that doesn't, you know, and you can't really have a conversation, I am moving you to the outer circle because this, you're often draining and this doesn't really serve. You know, it's so tricky. And I don't know how it translates into the evolutionary world, but there are also friends that are friends with other friends. So there's those other connections. And so that sort of changes the dynamic. You know, I don't know if it's the same within animals. And I loved reading, I'm going to digress for a second, because my dog has so many good friends. And I loved reading that they do. They are friends.
Yes.
And they, you know, we call them, there are people that will laugh and say, you know, I'll say, you know, Benny has a play date at his friends. And like, oh, and I'm like, no, they're friends. They can't wait to see each other. There are certain, you know, dogs that respond better to others and, you know, not even a breed thing or whatever, they just can tell. Same as people, I suppose.
Yes. My dog had a friend named Max that she used to meet up with in the park all the time. And that is one of the things, the fact that friendship or something like it exists in all these other species is the understanding that really has changed how scientists think about this, and it's what tells us that there's this evolutionary drive to be friendly. It's not just survival of the fittest and competition, it's survival of the friendliest, actually, because in animals, and so, well, to finish the thought, we always imagine that friendship is cultural. Most people did, right? That it's this lovely byproduct of the human ability to talk and have conversations and, you know, and of course, culture adds to it, but there's this much more fundamental thing going on there. And the way we know that is because in these other species, especially baboons and macaques and other non-human primates, where a lot of the work has been done, The animals with the strongest social bonds, and they can be, a lot of them are relatives, but not necessarily, and the exception proves the rule in this case. The strongest social bonds, they have the most babies, and the babies live longest, and the animals themselves live longest. And in evolutionary terms, you really can't do better than that. You need reproductive success and longevity. Sure. And nobody expected that the strength of social bonds would be the thing. Everybody thought dominance, hierarchy, because a lot of these animals have very strict hierarchies and things. And the scientists, the primatologists watching them, thought that would matter more. So they were really surprised.
What comes out of all of this? And it sounds like there were a lot of things that weren't as they seemed from some of the examples that you cited and also in the book. And I'm speaking with Lydia Denworth. Her book is called Friendship. It's just out. It's the evolutionary The Evolution, Biology, and Extraordinary Power of Life's Fundamental Bond, and so much science behind the longevity of life, the health of, you know, that it's your health. I love hearing that it sounds like hanging out with your friend, well, maybe at the gym would be a better place, is just as important as exercise.
If you go running or walking with your friend, it's a twofer.
It's a double. it's a double.
It's double.
Which is
why that's a great thing to do. But that, you know, it's an extra reminder that, you know, to look for those extra ways to find the time to spend with your friends, right? It's great.
Yeah, I mean, I think that when you're looking at time and prioritizing, and some people are more organized and some people are just like unyielding with their schedules, and then they're, you know, like, yeah, I feel like doing that thing last minute, which can be a really great way to get together. But if you can combine chores or, you know, meet up with a friend at the supermarket, even, I don't know, anything, you know, to get two things done. But also the sense of growing those bonds really need to be present. And I know you talk in here about how social media isn't necessarily a bad thing in terms of friendship, unless, of course, you're on the phone with your friend and you're not paying attention. So you need to really, if you're going to be there, you need to be there. But talk about how social media isn't as bad as we would think it would be.
Yeah, there's such hysteria. There's been such hysteria. And part of it is, there's a couple of things at work here. As a society, we have a history of really freaking out about technological change and innovation. We've done it for radio and television and all kind in the move to the cities, you know, the industrialization and things like that. But social media and digital technology, it's true, has been really seismic in the way it's saturated society. The science of social media is really new. The very first study of linking well-being and social media use was only done in 2006. And as is often the case, when you're first trying to figure out how to invest, how to experiment with it, you know, it was a pretty blunt kind of approach. So, for instance, they would count up total amounts of time spent online, and even that they did in a very blunt way, but not ask what were people doing online and with whom, right? And now and some of the science was sloppy and some of it was just early. And now what's happened is in the last year and a half, year to 2 years, there's been a raft of new work coming out that's been much more rigorous and that has also gone back and sort of pulled together everything else that's been done. That's a technically called a meta-analysis, and one just came out from Stanford University, and they found that really it, first of all, that the quality of a lot of the science wasn't that good, and also that it was sort of a trade-off. There were ways in which social media was good for us a little bit and ways it was bad, but generally neither thing was very strong, and they kind of canceled each other out. And the area in which it is best for because well-being means a lot of different things, but the place where it's most positive is relationships. And that if you use social media as an extra channel to strengthen your bond with someone, with a friend, that's great, and it does strengthen the bond. It's like just an extra way of communicating. If your only relationship is online, you know, it is a much more limited thing. But the other thing I notice is that you know, people all the time are pulling their hair out about saying, oh, you know, friendship is devalued currency. Facebook used the word and they ruined.
Oh, yeah. I don't buy it, though,
because we know the difference between our good friends, mm-hmm. our real, actual friends, and our Facebook friends who we never see and are only sort of tangentially connected to. And, in fact, when scientists went and asked people, they said only about 30-40% of their Facebook friends were, actual friends. And mm-hmm. and so, you know, let's give ourselves a little more credit. Right.
Exactly. We know a little bit of that.
We know a little something. And I also just, it's very important because I know most people are especially worried about teenagers, and I want to deliver the statistic that I hope will ease their mind, which is that researchers at the University of Oxford looked at data on more than 350,000 adolescents, and they found that social media use accounted for only less than 0.5% of the variation in well-being for those kids. Right. And things like eating a good breakfast mattered a lot more. Being bullied as a positive and being bullied mattered a lot far more as a negative. Wearing glasses, which I do a lot of the time, was worse for your well-being than how much time you spent on social media.
Fascinating.
And so, and they did a really rigorous analytical approach. Now, it's also fair to say what that tells us is that at a general population level, like all teenagers, we don't have to worry that, you know, any kid who's using social media is in trouble. What we need to do is ask better questions and be more careful in the science. Where we're going with this is that there's a science of social media 2.0 that is kind of underway, and it asks better questions. It asks about context and what you're doing online and with whom, and, you know, like things like video games. Video games are really important form of socializing, especially for boys, but also for girls. 97% of boys play video games and 83% of girls play video games. Teenagers. And they don't do it alone. 3/4 of them are with a friend or either online or in person.
So that's socializing, and that's a connection. All of these statistics are fascinating, and also so, you know, as with science and getting data of how the question is asked, like you mentioned earlier, like sloppy, you know, some of the sloppy or ways of asking or the data isn't exact where you would want it to be. I think that is always something, you know, when you're filling out a survey or you're being interviewed, like you have to be so careful, and you can hear the way a question's formulated and kind of, you know, you don't want to be led to your answer. I don't know. I think it's all very fascinating.
Yeah. I'm just going to leap in to say, yes, they found that if the survey used the term addiction, it was much more likely to find a negative result. And if it didn't, it, you know, if it was more neutral language, then it was much less likely to find a negative result.
Yeah. And I think that all of these, you know, you read this book, and it's really such, I think it's a great gift to give to your friends, or maybe it's a great gift to say, I'm sorry, I wish I saw you more. It's like highlight the parts that will speak to your relationship, and I'm speaking with Lydia Denworth. You can find her at lydiadenworth.com and on Twitter, and on, she's got an author Facebook page, and on Instagram a bit, and you will find her here in Rhode Island at the Cardigan Connection on Tuesday, February 18th. Where she'll be wearing her friendship bracelets and giving me one too. So I'm very excited about that. You talk about you were talking about kids just before, but I thought this was interesting that for people to know that children's friends take the place of the parents at some level as a, you know, a stress reliever
in their,
and a
right
buffer.
In their biology, that's the part that's so, I mean, we know that sort of socially, we know that friends become more important, but what was fascinating was when you look at how kids' brains process stressful situations, that up till puberty their parents sort of act as a calming influence, and then after puberty, it's like the parent is out of your hypothalamus, is what they say. It's like the parent.
I didn't think we were ever out of their hypothalamus, Lydia.
I mean, you're not. We are. Apparently, it's you know, it's not that we have no influence whatsoever, but we don't have that really basic physiological effect on the calming down. But friends can, not always, but in some do, and in some studies they don't. And what they discovered, though, is that it depends on what the situation is. So one of the studies that found that friends didn't serve as a calming influence asked kids to give a speech about why I, Lydia, make a good friend to you, and then you're doing that to your friends. And they realized afterwards that was a really terrible way to set up the study, because of course it's stressful to talk about yourself as a friend to your friend. And when I told my kids about it, they said, well, oh, God, no, I would never
right.
do that. But
right. Like who thought that was a good idea? And you also talk in the book about why it's important to model friend behavior and to teach children how to navigate and give them tools for building these friendships. You know, when they're little, you have friends come over and it's play groups, and a lot of that's orchestrated, and then they're sort of off on their own in school, and then we know what happens there. It could happen. So having that open dialogue of what's going on with the friends, and I mean, there's certainly parents that overmanage their kids' friendships, and that's a whole that could be a whole other podcast.
There are. And we don't want that. But I do think that one of the things we tend to do as parents is we think so much about achievement and, you know, discipline and structure, and even though we know that friends matter for kids, we don't actually always deliver the message that being a good friend and knowing how to make and maintain friends is one of the most important skills a kid can develop for life, and it will have an effect on that child's health and longevity over the course of their lifetime. And so I have started, I mean, doing this work myself, doing all of this reporting and mm-hmm. talking to so many people has really changed fundamentally the way I parent. I just bring in, I consider the friendship factor more in my parenting decisions. And I'm not saying that you have to let kids hang out with their friends all the time or hang out with friends that you know are a bad influence.
Right. But that's a separate thing, yeah.
That's a separate thing. But just like things like sleepovers are mm-hmm. this beautiful, unstructured time just to hang out and put in those hours. And I say this as a parent who dreads being asked to host a sleepover or let my kid go. I like such, you know, it's such a problem. And now I've changed my mind. I really get that that's such a critical thing for kids to do.
We love the sleepovers, kids, and my kids always had sleepovers. They prefer to have the kids sleep here more. As kids, we would wait until my mother was on the phone and send a note. Can so-and-so sleep over? Check yes, check no, or like no box for no. And that was when we would ask, which is, you know, so irritating, I'm sure, because, you know, when you're on the other side
right,
of that.
Right, exactly.
But
right.
That we always thought that was kind of charming. But it's funny. I just actually had a sleepover with an old friend from high school. We had an old-fashioned sleepover. Last week, we had the best time. And
that's so great.
I know. Grown-ups can have sleepovers, too.
Playdates and all of it.
Yeah, well, it's also important. And you talk about men and men's friendships and how they value them and approach that. And, I mean, I certainly know a lot of men who have a lot of guy friends, or they maybe do golf together or they play cards or whatever. But it is a very different kind of relationship, just the connections, but also so important.
It is as important for men to have friends as it is for women. And while there are definitely differences and the sort of stereotypical differences that women do friendship face to face and men do it side by side, just like you said, they maybe do sports often. They spend less time talking about feelings and emotions and things. But they value friendship just as much. And in fact, it turns out that the similarities far outweigh the differences. And I think we're so focused often on the differences that we fail to see that. I just think it's interesting. Also, I noticed that historically, going back hundreds of years, that, you know, the thinking, because there was so much misogyny in the world and mm-hmm. still is, but the thinking then was that men had friendship, you know, down, like Montaigne and stuff like that, writing his essays about friendship, and women didn't have the capacity to do it on this deep level. Entirely the other way.
Yeah, it doesn't sound right to me. Right.
No, it's like, of course, everybody can be good friends and values having friends. And that's the really important thing. But it is true that men should be encouraged to go out and spend time with their friends. And if they are married and have wives, the wives should encourage it, that we all of us benefit from some time, some building up relationships, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, it's one of the things that makes life so rich. And it's something I always have prioritized and valued deeply, and especially long friendships and new friends. And I think that's another thing that's important. It's never too late to make new friends or to make new old friends. I mean, you have to get those hours in. So, again, it's 50 for an acquaintance to a friend and then 200 to really get in there. I could just see people, like, logging in time. Okay, does this 3.5 hours? Is it three? No, but it's that idea. And it's nice to have a number to look at and really give that some thought of how do you get that to the level that you want. And you also mentioned when we first started chatting about checking in with yourself and knowing where friendship is, where you place it in your huge line of to-do things, the to-do list, and also adjusting when things don't feel right and sort of checking in with yourself on that. And all of the science behind this, and what are you hearing from readers? The book's just out, I know, but I think this is such a great book club pick because that's a whole other level of intimacy in some ways.
It's already a couple of book clubs who are doing it. It does seem that not all book clubs are into nonfiction, and a lot of people are intimidated by science, even though it's popular science. So
it's
hope
very
you can
it's cool
attack.
Science. Yeah, this is very, great. This is my kind of science, Lydia.
It's very. I try hard to make it super accessible and to
it
also
is.
Sort of build in the human real life examples that resonate and show how that you know. And I think what I hope that people book club pick, and I am finding that the early readers, I mean, it is just out as we're speaking,
sure.
But people don't always expect to learn something and then are so surprised by how much more they are learning and how differently they are thinking about their own relationships and their history of friendships. And, I mean, it leads to all kinds of really interesting discussions.
So much discussion. And that's the thing about certainly book clubs and also just conversation. Books figure their way into the conversation so often. And I know what you're saying about
right.
people sort of staying away from the nonfiction for book clubs, and I'm always pushing it. I mean, certainly they'll read memoir, so then that's sort of nonfiction-ish, whatever, creative nonfiction. But there have been topics that I've discussed on the show, the ones that are interesting to me. And again, I'm speaking with Lydia Denworth. We're talking about friendship, her brand new book. It's just out, and visit her site at lydiadenworth.com. I think that you can have several book club meetings about this one book. But I really do think this is such a great pick, and people, you know, it expands you. You know, you want to expand your friendships, you want to expand your reading, your mind, you know, and it is such an accessible book. So I would highly recommend this for book club. I am also thinking of bringing it to one of my other groups that I have and sharing with everybody, and then we can chat about it. I think, you know, we want to discuss books and brings up other topics, things to think about, and people feel better about their exercise regimen if I'm harping on that because I'm like, this is so cool that there's such a benefit. You know, you want to know all the things you're doing right. So,
yes.
So take a walk with your friend, and you got a twofer, as Lydia mentioned. So I think this is a fabulous book club pick, and we have so many book club readers, book clubbers that pay attention to the Reading with Robin page and the podcast. So put
Great.
This one on your
well,
list.
Thank you for that. Thank you. I appreciate the recommendation.
My pleasure. I do. I think, you know, it's enough with World War II already. Pick something different.
I guarantee that people will come away on some, there will be something in there that speaks to everyone. And it does, I would like just to point out that it does sort of talk about friendship at all points in life.
Yes.
From, you know, how babies develop social brains through teenagers, through adulthood, and the end of life and later parts of life. And so there really is something in there for everyone, whether you are thinking about it as a parent, as a spouse, as a colleague, just as a friend, or how to live the last 20 years of your life, what you should focus on. It's all there.
Wow, the last 20 years. There is something for everyone. You say here the strength of relationships at 50 predicts your health at 80. So I suppose you look around your 50th birthday celebration and think,
yes.
Who's
exactly.
In it for the long haul?
Who's in it for the long haul? And it doesn't have to be the same people, but it is about that ability, like how strong how good are you at relationships on some level? The thing that is so important is that it is it's not just that you have the same relationships when you're 80 from when you're 50. It's that, how much time and attention did you give to relationships in general, and how much were you working on it, and how strong were they? And so I do think of it as kind of a muscle that we need to use all through life. At some times you have more time and other times you have less, but you should make some time. And think of it as a lifelong endeavor.
Yeah, use it or lose it, just like everything else. And it's so important. And I'm so thrilled to be able to share a book about friendship with the audience, and gives you a lot to think about. And we're looking forward to seeing you. So Lydia will be joining us at the Cardigan Connection February 18th in Providence. And you can find more at lydiadenworth.com. And I look forward to meeting you, my new friend, in person.
I know. And we're going to do exactly what we should. We're going to go from a distant relationship to an in-person relationship, and that's how you move forward.
Absolutely. And lots of tips. And people write to you. Is your email on your
website? Yes, on my website there's a contact page, and it does come straight to me.
That's awesome. So it's lydiadenworth.com, and put this on your book club list, people. And I look forward to seeing you in a couple of weeks. Thank you.
Great. I look forward to it. Thanks, Robin.
Thanks for tuning in to this week's installment of the Reading with Robin podcast. As always, our full-length podcasts will be available right here on robincall.com. We appreciate your support and look forward to having you over next week when we chat with our next featured guest. Have a great week and happy reading.